Welcome, everybody. It's a great pleasure to have you all here this evening for our semi-annual Sidney Krum concert of music from the YIVO archives. I'm Jonathan Brent. I'm executive director of the YIVO Institute. This concert series was started in 2010, so this is our sixth year. We are extremely grateful to Michael Levitt for curating tonight's show, tonight's performance. You will hear from Michael shortly. Yuval Waldman is the artistic director of this series, who is taking a brief sabbatical for this present season. Let me tell you a little bit about the YIVO Institute and why this series is so important to us. YIVO was founded in 1925 in Vilna, Poland, now Vilnius, Lithuania. The purpose of the Institute was both to collect as much material about the Jewish world of Eastern Europe and Russia as it possibly could, and to study it. And to study it as a subject of the most urgent importance. Why? If you go to the university and you study Greek or Latin or German or French or mathematics, those subjects are out there and you have a relationship to those subjects. You are studying mathematics for mathematics, you're studying Greek for Greek, you're studying German to become proficient in the German language. But the purpose of study of the YIVO Institute was to study the object that was inside, because it was Jewish history itself, and through Jewish history, the idea of coming to understand what Jewish identity in the modern world consisted of. And so that's why this was a subject of the most urgent importance to those who founded the YIVO Institute. And over time, from 1925 to 1940, YIVO amassed the largest archive and the largest library in the world of East European materials. In 1940, the director of YIVO, Max Weinreich, miraculously was able to escape from Europe and come to New York City. And YIVO became the only institution, cultural institution, the only Jewish cultural institution to make the transition from Europe to America in the time of the Holocaust. And by virtue of doing that, YIVO here in New York has become the conservator and the perpetuator of the civilization, of the culture, of the heritage of those people it represented and wished to study and wished to develop a higher consciousness of their own identity. And today, YIVO, through its educational programs, through its archival research, through its library and its vast resources worldwide, is continuing that purpose and that mission. We are doing so today through this project, which we call the YIVO Vilna Collections, and there are brochures outside if you wish to learn more about it. This is the biggest project, the largest project in the Jewish world today, of the digitization of documents from the history of Jewish life in Eastern Europe and Russia. Approximately somewhere between 1.5 and 2 million documents ultimately will be digitized, put online, and made available through a web portal for people worldwide to study, to learn. And these materials will consist not only of pieces of paper, but also of music and of art. To give you an idea of why this work is interesting and why this work is something to become aware of today, I would just like you to look at the cover of your brochure for this evening, the program brochure. The image that you see here is from the Petersburg folk music organization. This image contains Yiddish, it contains Hebrew, it contains German, and it contains Russian. And you may ask yourself why, if this is the program brochure for a concert that is going to take place in Petersburg, Russia, why it would include German. Yiddish, of course. Hebrew, perhaps. But why German? And in conversation earlier, I was asking Michael Levitt this very question. He said, well, because there was a branch of the organization in Berlin. And what this shows us is something unique to the character of the Jewish life, the Jewish cultural life at that time, something that I think we need to become aware of as to the nature of the identity of Jewish cultural creation and production of the time, which is you are in Petersburg, but you are thinking of Berlin. You are in Berlin, but you're thinking of Palestine. You are in Palestine, but you're thinking of Minsk, or you're thinking of New York. And it is precisely this global conception of Jewish activity that defines so much of the work, whether it is in Yiddish or whether it is in Russian or whether it is in German or Hebrew at that time. And another wonderful fact about this cover design is that the man, the artist, there were three artists who worked on cover designs for this particular organization in Petersburg, but one of them was Leonid Pasternak, the father of Boris Pasternak. And what we understand from this is the extent to which Boris Pasternak, the great so-called Russian artist, is in fact himself steeped in a great tradition of Jewish culture and Jewish cultural heritage. And this is a heritage with which YIVO is committed in every way that it possibly can to perpetuate and to gain greater insight in and knowledge of here in the United States through our programs today. So it's a tremendous pleasure introducing you to the Krum concert, which is our way of taking music out of our archive and presenting it on stage so that we can bring it to life once again. And I'm very grateful to Michael Levitt, who is the president of the American Society for Jewish Music, for partnering with us on this program and curating the show. Michael.
It's a special pleasure and privilege to be here tonight, and to partner with YIVO is always a wonderful experience, and the support that we get from the Center for Jewish History is long-term and the most valuable asset that the American Society for Jewish Music has. But this program in particular is very meaningful to us at the Society for one very particular reason. Jonathan mentioned YIVO's founding in 1925, but I want to take you back another decade and a half to 1908. That's when the Society for New Jewish Folk Music was founded. It really wasn't folk music. It was classical music based on Jewish folk music. At that point in time, the Tsar loosened the regulations and allowed an interest in ethnicity, as Jonathan well put it, identity. And composers took advantage of that moment to form this society, to explore their own Jewish identity, and to create a new classical music based often on Jewish themes, as you will hear tonight in this program. Our roots as the American Society for Jewish Music go back to 1908, in fact, and can be traced all the way from St. Petersburg to Berlin to Vienna to Palestine to New York, and with name changes. And the publications which were first done in St. Petersburg morphed as well to Vienna, to Berlin, to Palestine, and then in editions sometimes in New York. You'll see in your program where the composer's dates are given, that their birth dates are given and their death dates are given with the place where they died. Some, all were born in Russia, in effect, but and some died in Russia after migrating or immigrating to Berlin or other places and returned to Russia. But a fair number of them ended up in Hollywood and in New York. And with them, they took their colleagues, reformed, and became the American Society for Jewish Music. So the music that you're hearing tonight is particularly meaningful to us, and I think you'll be astounded by not only its beauty, but its power for contemporary music in that time, and for Jewish music in particular. Before I introduce Dr. Lily Wohl, who is the executive director of the Jewish Music Forum, I want to mention one program change. The first piece in your program will be last, and the last piece will be first. The reason for this, we discovered tonight, is that the clarinetist in the last piece has another program to play and needs to be there by 8 o'clock, so we're giving him a pass and moving his piece first and moving the first piece last. Dr. Lillian Voll, executive director of the Jewish Music Forum.
Good evening. Tonight, the musicians performing will take you on a musical journey from Russia. In preparing for this event, it occurred to me that I know where the musical journey begins, but I didn't know where it ends. I suppose, at the very least, it leads us here tonight to the Sidney Krum Young Artists Concert Series at the Center for Jewish History in New York City. But that's really not the only place where the body of Jewish art and concert music leads us. In taking this musical journey together, listening to instrumental and vocal pieces from some of the most beloved Russian Jewish composers associated with the St. Petersburg Society for Jewish Folk Music, we bring back into focus not only the lives of these composers as they lived them as young men in Russia during their conservatory studies with the great composer Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, but also the contemporary significance of the music they made, music based on great Jewish folk melodies and motifs, prayer modes and ornamentation suggestive of cantorial recitatives, secular dances and life cycle celebrations. But these composers' musical journeys from Russia, which resulted in many cases in the arrival of their bodies of work and bodies as selves to new countries, stays with us as a creative force as we continue to imagine a Jewish musical experience from Russia to the concert this evening, and even into the future. As such, I thought I'd take the opportunity tonight to speak briefly about the legacy of the St. Petersburg Society for Jewish Folk Music in Argentina, the country where I conduct most of my own research in Jewish music. This material is based on documents housed in the Fundación YIVO, which is the sister organization of the YIVO Institute here in New York. Following these remarks, I'll introduce the first two pieces and the composers who wrote them, later introducing new composers periodically throughout the concert. Okay. On August 25th, 1925, the Sociedad Israelita Pro Cultura Musical, or SIPCAM as I'll refer to them tonight, was established in Sarmiento Street in Once, one of Buenos Aires' neighborhoods notable for its Jewish institutions and its substantial Jewish immigrant population. The premise for founding the organization was relatively simple. The founders wanted to develop a society to support music in general, and Jewish music in particular. They created a mixed choir directed by a man named Hubert Brandenburg, and an orchestra directed by violinist E. Mises. Furthermore, the founders of CPCIM started a music school for quote-unquote serious instruction, and sought to organize conferences and stimulate conversations about different themes and issues in music. Their rhetoric embraced discourses of modernity and drew on various dimensions of music's representational and performative meanings as a civilizing force to advance and attain cultural and social progress for Jews in Buenos Aires. CPCIM was a private institution. Members were required to pay monthly membership fees and were forbidden from joining similar institutions or organizations. Modeling itself as a modern musical institution, the organizers fostered creative activity as a means to showcase Jewish arts and cultural development. According to historian Pablo Palomino, between 1926 and 1934, the CPCIM had grown to include over 228 members. And here in this photocopy, scanned photograph from the archive in Buenos Aires, you can see some of the original members of the society. In the 1920s, CPCIM assumed the role of promoter of Jewish music in Buenos Aires. By imagining an emerging Jewish Argentine ethnic identity crafted around and defined by musical sound worlds stemming from Western classical music and the unique contributions of the art music of Russian Jewish composers and folklorists, CPCIM members extended the aims of the original St. Petersburg group to Argentina and built community around musical life. Not only did the founders of CPCIM have a deep love for beautiful music, but they craved an identifiably Jewish musical presence in Argentina. And thus, they promoted music making and education as an essential means for facilitating Jewish ethnic nationalism while promoting a positive image for Jews in Argentina in the public sphere. The CPCIM organizers made it their goal to make the community aware of all that has been done in the development of Jewish music by those artists who had given their talents in service to the people. It's perhaps no surprise then that among those composers whom they considered had appropriately given their talents, they included people like Joel Engel, Anton Arensky, Solomon Rosowsky, Joseph Achron, Leo Zeitlin, Abraham Elstein, Meyer Posner, and Zavol Zilberts, whose music could be heard in many different concerts that took place in the late 1920s and early 1930s in Buenos Aires. Music, some of which you'll have the chance to hear tonight. Not unlike the activities of the founders of the Jewish Music Forum, which was established by Abraham Wolf Binder in New York City in 1939, CPCIM served an important purpose making a new home for Jewish music in the rapidly changing urban environs of Buenos Aires, which received approximately 225,000 Jewish immigrants from the 1860s to the 1930s, most of whom arrived from Eastern Europe and Russia. However, the Jewish Music Forum in New York City, which operated until 1963 when it became the Jewish Liturgical Society of America, later reorganizing as the American Society for Jewish Music in 1974, still has lasting resonances today. In 2004, the Jewish Music Forum was reimagined and reestablished in part by the work of Russian Jewish music expert and historian James Leffler, as well as by Michael Levitt, president of the American Society for Jewish Music, and ethnomusicologist Mark Kligman. But in Argentina, the Sociedad Israelita Pro Cultura Musical's legacy is little known after it was forced to merge with the Joel Engel Musical Association in June 1934, relinquishing its name and its original focus due to difficulties financing the group. In the first years of the 20th century, fueled by nationalist sentiment drawing together young Russian Jewish musicians around powerful ideas of a shared interest in the value of Jewish culture and the potential for Jewish music, the composers and musicians associated with the St. Petersburg Society for Jewish Folk Music launched an artistic process rooted in a deep passion for sustaining the Jewish arts, music above all. from a group of young Jewish conservatory students studying under the legendary composer Rimsky-Korsakov, a rich and diverse body of music was produced and traveled around the world, inspiring new journeys like the one we'll be taking this evening. The first two pieces you will hear are compositions by Aleksandr Krein and Joseph Achron. And our journey begins in Russia with the clarinet quintet, Jewish Sketches No. 1 by Aleksandr Krein, who remained in the Soviet Union until his death in 1951. The piece was written between 1909 and 1910, shortly after his graduation from the Moscow Conservatory in 1908, where he also studied cello. Krein came from a very musical family of folk musicians, and his work draws from the klezmer and East European folk music traditions he heard in his childhood, as well as from his conservatory training, which is said to have fostered his interest in the, quote, harmonic language of modern composers such as Debussy, Ravel, and in particular, Scriabin. On the other hand, Joseph Achron did not remain in Russia. Hailed as the, quote, the most underestimated musician of our time by Arnold Schoenberg, Joseph Achron, a violinist born in Lithuania, is remembered for his skills in a variety of musical idioms, composing sacred music for the synagogue, concert halls, and popular theaters. Achron arrived in New York City in 1925, eventually heading further west to Los Angeles to try his hand at composing for film and television. Tonight, we'll be hearing his Hebrew melody for violin and piano in A minor, first published in 1914.
Thank you.
The second section of the concert this evening features songs composed by Joel Engel and Lazare Saminsky, as well as a piano trio by Solomon Rosowsky. All three men were original founders of the St. Petersburg Society for Jewish Folk Music, contributing to Jewish music in different ways, each carving out and in some cases struggling with the new lives they established once they left Russia. Joel Engel, nicknamed the father of Jewish music, was born in Berdyansk, now part of Ukraine, and didn't begin his musical studies until about the age of 17. At the recommendation of Russian composer Tchaikovsky, whom Engel met in 1893, Engel started his formal musical studies at the Moscow Conservatory. Engel's legacy is broad and far-reaching as a folk song collector, ethnographer, composer, and administrator. As one of the founding members of the Society for Jewish Folk Music, Engel was instrumental in facilitating the achievements of the society. And during his stay in Berlin in the early 1930s, as discussed earlier, he founded the YIVO Publishing House, which first published many of the scores utilized in the program this evening. In 1924, Engel moved to Palestine and died in Tel Aviv in 1927. Lazare Saminsky left Russia in 1919, arriving first to Odessa and later Palestine, with a stay in Istanbul as well. For 3 months, he toured Palestine before deciding to leave to head to the United States, where he arrived in 1920 to work as a guest conductor for the Boston and Detroit Symphony Orchestras. In the United States, Saminsky held the prestigious job of music director at New York City's own Temple Emmanuel, and wrote a vast array of musical works, including liturgical, choral, operatic, and other compositions in Hebrew and Yiddish. Betraying his belief in a nationalistic framework for Jewish music, Saminsky responded to criticism about his edition of classical sacred works by non-Jewish composers in religious services at Emmanuel with the following quote, according to James Leffler, quote, "There's no such thing as Christian versus Jewish music," he argued, "since it only makes sense to speak of Jewish music versus German or Italian or Russian music," end quote. The statement, as Leffler points out, perhaps seems somewhat out of step with American Jewish culture at the time, but also tells us a little bit about Saminsky's way of thinking about Jewish music. After studying in the conservatory in St. Petersburg, the third composer, Solomon Rosowsky, the son of a famous chazan in Riga, now Latvia, returned to his hometown in 1920, where he created a short-lived Jewish National Conservatory of Music. In 1925, he taught at the New School for Social Science. In 1925, he left for Palestine and eventually moved to New York City in 1947, where he taught at the New School for Social Science Research and the Jewish Theological Seminary. First, you'll hear now in the second part of the program two songs from Joel Engel's Three Songs to Poetry by Shaul Chernyakovsky, followed by, followed by Lazare Saminsky's Esther Song, and finally Rosowsky's Fantastische Tanz, or the Fantastic Dance, based on a Hasidic melody.
Yes.
Like Aleksandr Krein, Moyshe Milner remained in Russia after his studies at the Saint Petersburg Conservatory, which took place from 1907 to 1915. By the 1920s, although initial state-sponsored Jewish music events seemed a promising outlet for Jewish musical creativity, Milner and others were soon subjected to Soviet purges and bans on their music. In 1923, Milner premiered his Yiddish opera, Die Himmel brennen, where the heavens are burning, thought to be the first full-length Yiddish opera. However, it was shut down by the government and amid accusations of revolutionary ideals after just a handful of performances. While you may be familiar with his song, In Cheder, you may not be as familiar with his song, Tanz, Tanz, Medele Tanz, performed this evening. Based on texts from Yitzhak Leib Peretz, Yitzhakle Peretz, published in Kiev in 1921. The songs, to quote Albert Weiser, depict the fantasy world of the child, exhibiting some of the salient qualities which make Milner such a unique Jewish composer, namely a manner of welding Yiddish folk song elements and the various substances of Eastern European nusachot into a moving and individual musical tonality. The second set of songs in this portion of the program were composed by another composer named a celebrated Yiddish art song composer, Lazare Weiner, who was born in Cherkasy, Ukraine in October 1897 and studied music in the conservatory in Kiev. In 1914, at the age of 17, Weiner left Eastern Europe for New York City, where he found work as a piano accompanist and a voice teacher, eventually joining and playing as an accompanist with famous cantors such as Yasla Rosenblatt, David Reutemann, Gershon Sirota, Zavel Quartin, and Berla Chagi. Musicologist Marcia Brian Edelman notes in Weiner's obituary that while Weiner knew very little Yiddish as a young man, his friendship with violinist and Yiddish poet Nachum Baruch Minkoff kickstarted a deep love and lifetime engagement with Yiddish, inspiring many of his most important musical compositions. In New York, Weiner developed friendships with former members of the Saint Petersburg group, including Lazare Saminsky, Joseph Achron, and Solomon Rosowsky. In 1930, Weiner's career took him in new directions in Jewish music when he became the music director of New York Central Synagogue. There, he commissioned numerous works for Central Synagogue and directed the premiere of Ernest Bloch's Sacred Service and the New York premiere of Darius Milhaud's Sacred Service. The songs you hear tonight by Lazare Weiner are Tzelet Zeldi, based on a poem by Jakob Gladstein, and Funfaititig, from distant days, based on a poem by Halperin Levick. Like many of the composers featured this evening, violinist Leo Zeitlin left Russia for the United States in the early 1920s. And later he worked in theaters and as a conductor and arranger for Capitol Radio and NBC. Elizion, the piece featured this evening, is evidence of a renaissance of Zeitlin's music in recognition of his once forgotten musical works. And the final piece this evening, by Mikhail Gnesin, is emblematic of a composer who has been called by Jim Leffler sort of one of the most complex for his ability to exemplify the dynamics of Jewish visibility and vulnerability reflected in the twists and turns in the life of one of the Society for Jewish Folk Music's original founders. Gnesin remained in Russia for the majority of his adult life and career, even after multiple visits to Palestine. A Jew, a Marxist, and an avant-garde composer, Gnesin struggled as the Soviet regime imposed more and more restrictions on him and his colleagues toward the end of the 1920s, eventually culminating in direct state control of cultural life and the dissolution of all private organizations in 1931. Gnesin's variations on a Jewish folk theme exemplify this interest in Yiddish folk songs and his insistence on experimentation with Jewish themes during his earlier and freer period of compositional work.
Thank you. Thank you.